Module 25, Lift Ground, Sugar Lift Ground Etching. The technique of etching using the sugar solution helps to refine the artist's brushwork and preserve it for printing on the plate. Hence, this technique is of vital importance. The etching technique preserves the brushworks and permits broad areas of color instead of thin dry lines. It is still quite unsure who exactly invented this technique, but the printmakers who propagated the technique found instant fame and success. The technique involves using a sugar solution to paint over the chosen metal block. Some artists use a solution of sugar and black ink. Once the image is painted on the plate, the entire plate is then coated with an acid-resistant varnish. Once dry, the plate is immersed in warm water, the sugar mixture melts, lifting away part of the varnish. The plate is then grained for texture using an aquatint method and dipped in acid. When the varnish has been lifted, the acid bites into the plate. In printing, ink gathers in this edged area and creates a rich black tone on the paper. The design to be printed has to be of the same dimensions as the size of the block, that is 7 inches into 7 inches. Prepare several sketches to refine the design and select one for printing. One has to note that in lift ground etching, a positive image is etched on an aquatint plate by drawing with a water-soluble ground. In the conventional aquatint technique, the artist controls the image by chopping out negative areas with varnish, thus working around the positive image. But for lift ground etching, he uses a viscous liquid, such as India ink, gamboge, or ordinary poster paint mixed with sugar syrup, to paint directly on the plate. After the painting is finished and dried, the whole surface is covered with thin liquid hard ground. When dry, the plate is placed in lukewarm water that dissolves the painted design, lifting the ground and dislodging it from places that had been painted, thus exposing the metal surface to be etched. Aquatint can be handled two ways. Either the whole plate can be aquatint before painting with lift ground, or it can be aquatint after the design is lifted. Lift ground etching is particularly well suited to free, spontaneous, calligraphic designs. Sugar lift aquatint is also known as lift ground etching. The design to be printed has to be of the same dimension as the size of the block, that is 7 inches into 7 inches. Prepare several sketches to refine the design and select one for printing. Another technique is sugar lift resist, similar to gout resist. Instead of painting with white gouge onto paper, one paints with a mixture made from syrup, black poster paint, and liquid detergent onto a sheet of cleaned copper. Take an ordinary paint brush, dip into the syrup mixture, paint on copper, then wait for it to dry. Once dry, paint a thin layer of hard ground over the top. Wait for the hard ground to dry, then place the plate of copper in warm water. The sugar mixture with the help of the detergent should then lift off the plate, exposing the copper beneath it. You can rub the hard ground covered plate in the water gently with your fingers to help the lift along. Once all the sugar mixture has lifted off the plate, take the copper plate out of the water, wait for it to dry. When dry, you can then either put a layer of Accutane over the top of the exposed copper for a sugar lift Accutane and then place it in acid. Or you can place the plate directly into the acid. Some open biting will occur, but this will add to the effect if needed. Slope the edges of the entire block using a metal file. This technique is called beveling the block edges. Robert Motherwell. Robert Motherwell is an American painter and printmaker. He is associated with the abstract expressionistic movement. Robert Motherwell is better known for his collages, which have a whimsical and autobiographical flavor and content. His earliest being in 1940s, which were devoted to World War II theme. The abstract expressionists mythologizing of World War II has usually been interpreted as a radical artistic and psycho-cultural response to political tragedy itself. Motherwell's appropriation of journalistic war imagery in his collages can be seen as a statement that changed the expressionist maker's idealist mythical response to the war, which evaded the socio-political challenges of modern history and the allegorical signifying systems which constituted modern historical understanding. Carefully polish the surface to be etched clean with Brasso, degrease the block. This is carried out by cleaning the entire block with soap. Robert Motherwell was born in Aberdeen, Washington in 1915, but he spent most of his childhood in the dry environments of Central California, which he was sent in an effort to relieve his severe asthma. The son of a well-to-do and conservative bank chairman, Motherwell was expected to follow in his father's footsteps. From early on, though, Motherwell displayed an affinity for more intellectual and creative pursuits, and his early education included a scholarship to study at the Otis Art Institute in Los Angeles. Motherwell devoted himself to art practice entirely when he received an extensive education in philosophy, literature, and art history. He began his study at Stanford University, where he earned a BA in philosophy in 1937. There he encountered the philosopher Alfred North Whitehead and the work of French symbolist poets, and these twin inspirations helped to open Motherwell's mind to the possibilities of abstractions in writing and art. Next, this clean block is applied with hard ground and smoked on the side to be etched. Draw or trace the design or sketch on the block. This sketch can be further improved at the time of the final drawing on the block. After graduation, he began a PhD program in philosophy at Harvard, but his studies were interrupted by a year-long European trip which he embarked upon in 1938, and during which he fell in love with European modernism. It was only at his father's insistence that he chose a stable occupation, which led him to study art history at Columbia University in 1940, instead of immediately beginning his career as an artist. Motherwell's time at Columbia, however, proved to be significant for his artistic development. Upon his arrival to New York, he fell in with the circle of painters who would make up the core of the abstract expressionist movement. Another powerful influence was art historian Meir Schafiro, who was then teaching at Columbia. Schafiro encouraged Motherwell's painting and introduced him to the group of European surrealists living in New York at that time. He was deeply impressed by their notion of automatism, the idea that art might be manifestation of the artist's subconscious, and it would become a central tenet of his work. Motherwell's first known works were composed during a 1941 trip to Mexico with the surrealist painter Roberto Mata. These 11 pan and ink drawings, collectively called the Mexican Sketchbook, show the influence of Surrealism. Yet, they are essentially abstract in nature and balance formal composition with spontaneous invention. Motherwell's career then received a jump start in 1943 when Paddy Guggenheim offered him the opportunity to create New York for a show of collages by several European modernists. Now draw the image on the block with the help of sugar and blank ink solution. After drawing out the design on the block, keep the block to dry completely. Once it is dry, slowly and gently wash the block with warm water. The block is now to be etched using a nitric acid 60% purity solution. This is the etching solution. To prepare the etching, mix carefully 1 part nitric acid with 8 parts water in a plastic tray, 1:8 proportion. The backside of the block to be etched is first covered with an acid-resistant coat, either of black Japan or plastic sticker. In the 1940s, Motherwell also began parallel careers in teaching, editing and writing. Over the next 2 decades, he taught at Black Mountain College in North Carolina. He helped to establish an art school subject to the artist in New York, Greenwich Village. And he also taught at Hunter College. He wrote for the Surrealist publication VVV in 1941 and later edited the extremely influential document of modern art series, The Publication Possibilities and the Dada Painters and Poet Anthology. He would continue to lecture and write about art throughout his long career. The Elegies to the Spanish Republic series, the career spanning group of over 140 works for which the artist is perhaps best known, began as a small drawing created in 1948 to accompany a poem in Possibility. A year later, Motherwell reworked the sketch as a painting called At 5 in the Afternoon, so named for a poem by Federico Garcia Lorca, a poet who was executed during the Spanish Civil War. Composed between 1953 to 1957, the artist's second major group of work is called the Jetem series, after the French phrase that appeared on each canvas. These works feature a brighter and broader palette than the Elegies painting, yet they maintain the same dialogue between the strictly formal compositions of European modernism and the more spontaneous, emotionally expressive methods of the abstract expressionist movement. Now to prepare the ink to be used on the block, a few drops of black ink is poured onto the inking glass. A few drops of linseed oil are added to the ink. Using a brayer or a roller, the ink and oil are mixed on the inking glass. Now this ink is ready to use on the block. In 1961, Motherwell began to reinvent his collages as limited editions of lithographic prints. He would later on be heavily employing the techniques of etching, which granted a better output with depth as the person himself. He would become the only artist in the first generation of abstract expressionists to utilize printmaking as a major part of his artistic practice. Motherwell's collages from this period also started to incorporate the detritus, cigarette wrappers, etc. of his daily life. These autobiographical references hint again at the artist's interest not only in formal and intellectual concerns, but also his continued engagement with the external world and his own emotions. As arguably the most eloquent and intellectually accomplished of all the New York School painters, Robert Motherwell's legacy is significant not only for the importance of his paintings and prints, but also for the breadth and influence of his writing, editing, and teaching. Yet it is first and foremost in the artist's work which both bridged and challenged the dual influences of European and American modernism, and which, despite its interest in formal dialogues, never neglected the necessity of human empathy, that Motherwell's legacy will continue to endure. Unlike many of his friends and contemporaries in the abstract expressionist movement, whose lives and careers burned brightly but for far too short a time, Motherwell would continue to work productively throughout the next 30 years. He spent these years painting, printmaking, lecturing, and further expanding upon the themes that had occupied his entire life. After a long and prolific career, the artist died in 1991 at his home in Provincetown town, Massachusetts. health and safety precautions. One, store concentrated nitric acid and potassium chloride separately from other chemicals. Whenever possible, use diluted acid. Acid etching should be done with local exhaust ventilation. Second, an important safety rule when diluting concentrated acids is to add the acid to the water, never the reverse. Third, wear appropriate gloves, goggles, and protective aprons or lab coats when handling acids. If acid is spilled on your skin, wash with lots of water. In case of eye contact, rinse the eyes with water for at least 15 to 20 minutes and seek medical attention. Fourth, cover acid baths when not in use. Fifth, nitric acid action releases the respiratory irritant nitrogen dioxide, which has poor odor warning properties. During the etching processes, flammable hydrogen gas is also produced. Concentrated nitric acid is a strong oxidizing agent and can react with many other chemicals, especially solvents or other organic compounds, to cause a fire. Sixth, concentrated acids are corrosive to skin, eyes, respiratory system, and gastrointestinal system. Dilute acids can cause skin irritation on repeated or prolonged contact. Concentrated nitric acid is a strong oxidizing agent and can react explosively with other concentrated acids, solvents, etc. Nitric acid gives off various nitrogen oxide gases, including nitrogen dioxide, which is a strong lung irritant and can cause emphysema. Seven, always work in a well-ventilated area. If in a closed space, keep the windows open at all times. Eight, read the safety, handling instructions and caution labels on nitric acid bottles and containers carefully. 9. Always wear acid-resistant gloves, safety goggles, apron, and respirator while handling acids. Tenth, in the case of an accident or your need for assistance, make sure someone else in the room is aware of what you are doing. Should the ad solution splash or come in contact with skin and is allowed to remain in contact with skin, the result will be a severe burn. It can be washed off immediately with plenty of water and follow these general guidelines. Always keep a container of cold water nearby in cases of an accident. If your skin comes in contact with the acid, wash the area immediately with plenty of cold water and soap for a minimum of 15 minutes. Get a medical attention. If your body should come in contact with the acid, wash your entire body with the hose from the draining sink for a minimum of 15 minutes. Get immediate medical attention. 16. Moderate acids and inks can be water-based or solvent-based, and hence care has to be taken that if a student has any respiratory allergies, asthma problems, appropriate aeration is provided. 14. Arching needles and tools should be stored safely, and one should always cut away from yourself. In advance, locate the nearest first aid box. 15. When possible, clamp down plates to avoid slipping. Minimize the chance of carpal tunnel syndrome by choosing tools with wide handles, avoiding tight grips, and including hand flexing exercises during regular test periods. Set work table height so wrist flexing motions are minimal. 16. Sharp metallic tools for techniques like dry point, etching, engraving, and mezzotint have to be used carefully and with a firm hand. Keep sharp tools under lock and key. 17. Rosin powder is a fine dust which can get into the respiratory system easily. While dusting the block, always keep the nose and mouth covered and eyes too. The paper to be used to print is kept soaked and blotted half an hour before the print is taken and should be damp when being printed for intaglio processes. A final registration is made on the machine before the block is inked. It should be noted that the intaglio process fills up ink in the block crevices and the upper relief surface area should be wiped clean and over the edges too.